Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Jayo Radha Landanishwar Radha Landanishwar Radhe Jayo Jagannath Jagannath Baladev Jaya Subhadra Prabhupad, 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 Jaya Prabhupad,
Jaya Prabhupad, Prabhupad, Jaya Jaya Prabhupad,
Jaya Jaya Gurudev, 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 Jaya Gurudev.
ज्ञान तिमिरंदस्य
ज्ञानांजनाशलाकाय
चक्षुरुन्मीलितां येन तस्मै श्री गुरुवे नमः नमः ओम विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी इति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात देशतारिणे वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे सो वेलकम Everybody, Hare Krishna. So for the next few minutes, we are trying to discuss about the topic, the lessons to be learned in the Grihastha Ashram, is it right? The lessons to be learned. So, you know, when I first saw this topic, which she sent me by mail, I said, there's one way of looking at it is, what lessons do we learn after being in the Grihastha Ashram? And on the lighter note, I said the best lesson you learn is don't enter it. I'm sorry?
You have to grow up.
Correct. That's on the lighter side, I said. No? Just on the lighter side. But what she actually meant was that what do we really need to understand so that we can have a stable married life. And why we need to have a stable married life? So that we can execute Krishna consciousness properly. Because unless and until you are properly situated on a stable platform, you can't really execute Krishna consciousness properly. For example, it will not be very easy for anyone to execute Krishna consciousness if that person is going hungry. I mean, we talk about the soul, the need of the soul, and that is the holy name which Prabhupada has given us. But unless and until we deal with the needs of the body, the needs of the mind, the needs of the emotions, and then comes the need of the soul. So, as we understand, that for a stable married life, I mean for a stable Krishna conscious life, the way Prabhupada has given us, it is important to have a very, very stable marriage. And for that, we need to first understand a very, very important aspect that many of us, all of you are practicing devotees, right? You are chanting Hare Krishna, you come to the temple practicing devotees. That the one of the things that really startled me when I first heard it from one of the very senior speakers is that a good devotee does not make a good grihastha. And I said, oh, that was a something which usually I never thought that way. That if I'm just a good devotee, then I'll be a good grihastha. But a good devotee doesn't make one a good parent also. A good devotee doesn't make one a good grihastha. A good devotee doesn't make one a good professional also. You have to be doing that aspect also properly. And you can't just say that I'll be a good devotee and everything will be all right. So that's why it's important to understand that while we are trying to be good devotees and we come to our temples, the temple is also offering the training on how to be good grihasthas. So in our Bhagavatam classes, we talk about how to be a good devotees. And the Bhagavatam is teaching us how to be good. But Bhagavatam also teaches us the importance of stable married life.
We see that Grihastha Ashram, you know, ashram word comes from the root ashray. Ashray means where you take shelter. So ashram is a place where you take shelter of Lord Sri Hari. So Grihastha Ashram is, you know, you remain in Griha, in the house, and you learn to take shelter of Lord Krishna. So before that, there is Brahmachari Ashram, then there is Vanaprastha Ashram, and then there is Sannyas Ashram. But Grihastha Ashram is mainly people who are staying in the house and they're staying together, husband and wife, staying together, learning to take shelter of Lord Shri Krishna. Also Vedic culture. We say in Vedic culture, there are the four ashrams and four varnas. So what is your understanding of culture? What do you think when you say the word culture, what comes in your mind? Yes.
Yes. Correct. Very good.
Something else?
Behavior.
Anybody who is a microbiology student here? You know? You have heard about culture? What is culture? You grow. Things grow when there is good culture.
You put this much dahi in.
This much yogurt you put in the milk and the entire milk becomes yogurt. So that is culture. So culture is where you grow. So similarly, a soul, the Vedic culture is made in such a way that a soul actually grows on a higher and higher platform of service to the Lord. So that's why this ashram, all the four ashrams are made in such a way that you come closer to Krishna. And together in Grihastha Ashram, husband and wife together perform their services to become closer to Krishna. It is considered as a bridge. You know, when you have to go from one place to another place, there's a bridge. So Grihastha Ashram is a bridge where man and woman, they come together, they stay together in Grihastha Ashram and they progress towards achieving the ultimate goal of life, which is serving Krishna. There are many, many different goals. There are different goals of Grihastha Ashram, and that Grihastha Ashram is a main ashram which is, you will see all around you. You know, in the material world, Grihastha Ashram is present everywhere. Everybody is normal, you will see married people. And when devotees who are Grihasthas, whatever way they are living, actually that's the way they come in contact with outsiders, and that's the best way to preach. Grihastha Ashram, it sustains and preserves the other three ashrams, because only in Grihastha Ashram you are allowed to work, earn money and maintain the other three ashrams. Grihastha Ashram is the one where you preach, because Vedic culture becomes exposed to the outsiders. Brahmacharis don't go out. You know, they may go for book distribution. But you know, going to people's houses and people coming to your house and seeing the way you take care of the deities or you dealing with each other, that happens only in Grihastha Ashram. There's an ample opportunity for preaching.
And so, you know, it is as she mentioned, it's like a bridge. And it is not, to cross this bridge is not very easy. It's not a cakewalk. It is important. That's why we need to understand there's certain challenges which come in the Grihastha Ashram, and how to balance, how to have what nowadays there's a lot of talk about work-life balance, right? Where we're talking about that, you know, let there be work-life balance in the corporate world. But it is also important to have a spiritual life and a Grihastha Ashram balance. Because, you know, as I was, we were in Hungary the other day, and we have some book or something. If I want to balance this on my finger, okay, then I put my finger here, it will fall down. Put a finger here. There's only one point in this whole paper, which is the point where I can balance this. Even a centimeter away, it will sort of start falling from the hand, right? So we have to find the right balance in our spiritual practices and our Grihastha Ashram duties, so that you don't become lopsided in any one of the things. Many a times what we see is that devotees, they tend to get too carried away by any one of the things. You know, either they become too active devotees, and by doing a lot of service and lot, which is good, but at the cost of ignoring your married life, and that causes problem in the married life. Or you get too attached to your married life and just too focused on your married life, and just my wife, my children, my house, ato griha kshetra sutta apta vitta janasamoha ammameti, as the shastras explain, that just being too attached to I and mine. And then you come to the other extreme and you sort of get you start compromising on your spiritual practices. So we need to understand what is it that is required for us to find this balance. And an important aspect of this balance is to understand what are the needs of each and every of the partner. What is the psychology? What is required duties to have a good, wholesome married life?
In very, very briefly, we can take from, I think most of you are married here. No, how many of you are not married?
Most of them are not married. So it is theory for them, theory.
Okay.
This is where they decide whether it's a good point.
Or they can decide.
It's just making sure the preparation's there before we step into married life, so we know to kill all the problems, have a strong foundation built.
When in our Bombay one sometimes, you know, when somebody gets married, we say, ding dong bell, one more down the well. So all of you are sitting on the periphery of the well, you're looking at the well. You need somebody to push you out in. You know? No. It's nice. It's nice that you prepare, have proper understanding, and then enter into something. So that's what we are trying. We will try to. Which one you will take?
So we can say that actually there is no impediment in Grihastha Ashram. You know, Grihasthas can also become wonderful devotees. You see the people who were closest associates of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, most of them were Grihasthas. Advaita Acharya, Nityananda Prabhu, Shivas Thakur. So many of them were Grihasthas. If you think, take 12 Mahajans. Out of 12 Mahajans, the 7 are Grihasthas. You know, so many, except the Bhishma and Brahma. And some of them, most of them are Kumaras, sorry. Most of them are actually Grihasthas. So Grihastha Ashram is not an impediment. Now I will speak something different because I know half of you are not married. So Grihastha Ashram is not an impediment to the spiritual life. But at the same time, it is like His Holiness Bhaktitirtha Maharaj used to give an example that you have a fast track and a slow track. You know, trains, I don't know whether you have in here, but we have in India some trains, they go just fast. And they reach the destination, beforehand. Other trains also reach the same destination, but they take some time. So in Grihastha Ashram, slow track train, and the Brahmachari Ashram is a fast, straight, detachment, and just reach straight to the destination with very less time. And Grihastha Ashram is a slow, but you reach. You stop at all the stations and then you reach. But what is the adage? If you fall down from the fast train, what happens? If a fast growing train, if you fall, you really break your bones. But a slow going train, if you fall, you again get down and you catch up the train. You know, you can't, you don't just completely destroy your spiritual life. So Grihastha Ashram is a slow track, but going to the same destination.
Another example that he gives, which will make it very clear, evident. You know, but trains might not be so much of a aspect known to you all, because those from Bombay will know about the trains. But you know, we go to airports, flights, right? And we have typically two types of travelers that we see traveling by flights. One is the light traveler, you know, where he just has the cabin luggage. He just comes with his cabin luggage and takes his ticket and just goes. There's no big trolley that he has. But other type of traveler, there are huge bags. There's one bag and two bag, and the children sitting on the bag. The bags are falling. You've seen that scene, right? You know, so many huge bags, and you know, he's just heavy luggage. But he stops at the same ticket counter and shows his ticket and goes to the same plane. So Bhaktijit Maharaj was explaining that both are traveling to the same destination. And where is the flight going? Back to Godhead. We are all trying to go back to God. We are all trying to purify our life and go to the feet of Krishna, or go to the feet of God, wherever you want to go. But one is a heavy traveler. That means Grihastha Ashram is a lot of responsibilities. You know, you have to, you know, work, you have to pay your bills, you have to ever take care of the inflation. As Madhuri was saying, she is constantly showing people the pink slip. Is it what you call it here? You call it pink slip here? No. Okay, the dismissals, okay? So you have to be competitive enough to hang on to your jobs and all these things. You have a responsibility, right? But you're going to the same destination. A brahmachari, I mean, you know, he has to just whole full time dedicate his life to Guru's mission, distribute books, do Harinam, you know, he get his two prasada meals, and he doesn't have responsibility. But both are going to the same destination. One thing is important. So Grihastha Ashram is ashram full of responsibilities, and because it is filled with responsibilities, we have the chance to do much more preaching, because it's an ashram which is a very social ashram. You're interacting with so many social people outside. They see the devotees are like them. They're wearing pant and shirt. You know, like Bhaktivinoda Thakur said that, you know, he wanted all professionals to become devotees who can mingle around with the people, and people see them exactly like them, but they're different. They're chanting Hare Krishna and they're leading a very pure life. So there's ample opportunity for preaching in Grihastha Ashram, which might be to that extent restricted in the renounced order of life.
One of the most important aspect in Grihastha Ashram is both husband and wife, they stay together, keeping Krishna in the center. What does it mean to keep Krishna in the center? Put the deity of Krishna right in the center of the house? No. Whatever activity you are doing, whatever you are earning, you offer it to Krishna. Whatever you cook, you offer to Krishna. Husband serves the spiritual master, and the wife assists the husband in serving the spiritual master. Their center of life is somehow or other together to hear, chant and remember about Krishna. You know, constantly a Grihastha, when keeping Krishna in the center, means they are constantly thinking of Krishna, making arrangement in such a way that entire family is together chanting the names of Lord Krishna, hearing about Krishna and remembering Krishna. And for that, they can have deities in the house, deity worship in the house, husband and wife together, chanting together in the house, morning. And also serving together in the house by inviting Vaishnavas and Sadhus. You hear of Gaur Mohande, who is Srila Prabhupada's father, that he would very regularly invite lot of Vaishnavas in their house for prasadam. And when they come for prasad, you serve them, whatever money you have earned, you buy bhoga, you cook, you offer them. And it is said that actually Krishna honors prasad through the mouth of the devotee brahmanas. So that is one service. The second service is husband and wife come together and they hear about Krishna. Hearing can happen either you invite some speaker and you hear, or you hear together a lecture either on internet or through a, you know, cassette recorder or a CD player. Because hearing actually makes your intelligence very sharp. A Grihastha has to constantly deal with material energy. When you are in the temple, staying in the temple, you don't deal so much with material energy. But a Grihastha is constantly dealing with the outside material energy. And what is he doing? He has to find out, keep a right balance, as Prabhuji was mentioning, you know, right in the center. So what he has to do, he has to check whether, if I do this activity, will this be helpful in my Krishna consciousness, or will it not be helpful in my Krishna consciousness? So for that, you need very sharp intelligence. You need discrimination power. And how does that come? That comes by very, very sharp hearing and chanting. A husband and wife coming together, they have to encourage each other to hear and chant. I know so many couples where the husband is working throughout the day, very busy in the office. But sometimes the wife who hears the lecture, who writes down some points, in the evening she discusses with the husband. So this is mutual cooperation together for hearing and chanting.
And you know, we will. It's important to understand what is the purpose of married life. You know, because before you enter into something, we know the purpose. So what is the purpose of married life? Is this sense gratification? From the spiritual perspective, are we coming together for sense gratification? That's not the focus of the reason. I mean, that's not the main purpose why we come to get married. The reason why we come to get married is together we can execute Krishna consciousness, help each other. As in spiritual mathematics, 1 + 1 is equal to, usually mathematics is 1 + 1 is equal to 2, right? But in spiritual mathematics, we have a different answer. 1 + 1 is equal to 11. That's the power of when people are together, working harmoniously together to make progress in Krishna consciousness. And so the goal is very clear. I mean, before you start your journey, you need to know where you are going. The goal is very clear, and because the goal is clear, you know the process is also, or the path is also very, very clearly mentioned. So one of the very important aspects of married life is charity. Because the whole idea of married life is how I can give charity in the form of knowledge, where grihasthas, if they have the capacity to give in charity of some knowledge, some philosophical knowledge to the society. But one of the main aspects, as mentioned as Shastras, whether it is Srimad Bhagavatam or Chaitanya Charitamrita, we have got amazing examples of grihasthas who have epitomized this particular aspect of charity, giving in charity. Because by nature, every ashram has its own duties to play. The duty of a grihastha is to support the other ashrams. And how do they support? By supporting it, because they are the only ashram which actually earns material wealth. So they are supposed to give in charity. So charity is a very, very important aspect in grihastha ashram. Because, you know, when you don't give charity, what happens? We become greedy. Like we have in the Shastras, that we have what is called man shuddhi. Our mind, even though we are trying to keep it pure, but because we are working in a very unhealthy, unclean environment, the mind gets polluted. You are walking and you see something which you are not supposed to see. You hear something which you are not supposed to hear. You can't keep your senses closed. You are exposed to these things. So how to do man shuddhi? By chanting Hare Krishna. Similarly, even if you are vegetarians, the fact that you are eating vegetarian food, still there is some sin incurred because we are eating plants. So there is some sin incurred in eating vegetarian food also. And how do we do Anna Shuddhi? Anna means food. How do we do Shuddhi? By offering food to Krishna, and that food becomes Prasad, and that's how you do Anna Shuddhi. And similarly, how do you do Dhana Shuddhi? Or how do you purify your wealth? Is you might be earning the wealth in a very honest way. You might be very straightforward. Many times it's difficult to be honest also. But you may be as honest as you can. But the people that you're working for, or the business that you're doing with somebody else, they might not be doing things in a straightforward way. So your money that you're earning is tinged, if not smeared, with a lot of sin. Right? So you need to purify your wealth. Otherwise that sin will affect your consciousness. And the way you purify your dhan, just like you purify your man by chanting your anna, by offering to Krishna, you purify your dhan by giving in charity. Now the important question is asked, that how much to give? Fine, I believe in charity, right? How much to give? Is that the question many times we have? How much to give? So, you know, we can't just decide a figure that, you know, you all have to give £500. You know, for somebody who is X person, he might be putting £500 every week in the hundi. And for him, it is nothing. But for somebody, it's like, oh my God, it is the whole month's salary. Right? So we cannot decide a figure, because what is amazing thing about God or Krishna, he doesn't see how much you give. You know what he sees? How much you hold back. So while you are giving, he's not seeing that. He's seeing behind you how much is there in your pocket. That's God. You know, people say, oh, he has given so much. But God doesn't see he has given so much. He will see at the back and how much you hold back. So the right amount to decide is when it just starts pinching you. You know, sometimes people ask, how what to do? I say, well, you know, if you are earning, say, £2,000, you know, that salary that you are earning. So giving £100 is very easy. I just take it. I'm just giving an example. Not that it may be easy, but I'm just giving an example. I don't know what is the cost of living in London, so I'm just giving an example. Okay, £100 is easy. £200 might be easy, but £300 is too difficult. But £250 is just when he starts pinching. Yes, that's the right amount. Because Krishna is really not interested in your wealth. God, because he's explained in the Brahma Samhita, Lakshmi Sahastra Satasam Brahma Sevya Manam Govindam Adipurusham Tamaham Bajami. If we are thinking that my charity is going to do something great for God, then I'm sorry, my dear friends, you are in a big illusion. That my £200 is going to, after all, you know, give one square meal to Radha Gau Londoneshwar. What is Brahma Samhita saying? Lakshmi Sahastra Satasam Brahma Sevya Manam. That Krishna is served by millions and millions of gopis or Lakshmis in the spiritual world. That this Brahma is saying as audio vision. You are seeing it and you are speaking about this. And he recited his prayers. And the millions of Lakshmi serving. What is your wealth of, what is your £200 or £500 or £1,000 going to do to Krishna? But you need to give it to him. So charity is a very, very important aspect of married life. So we need to understand that, you know, you see all these big people. I mean, not only, they're not necessarily devotees, Bill Gates. Or for that matter, the second, what is that person's name? Warren Buffett. They are setting an example for the world to follow, that how much, I mean, I really don't know, but yes, I know, I have my friends working in Microsoft in Seattle. And you know, Microsoft has a fantastic policy that whatever amount the employee gives in for some charitable cause, they have a matching grant. That if you give £1,000, the Microsoft gives £1,000 for any charity if the employees are giving. So that's the type of charity that he does, and that is phenomenally wonderful, right? So here is examples of people who are really reached great heights and great success. But what is really driving them is the aspect of charity. So that's important in the society and much more in a Krishna consciousness environment, because we understand as being devotees that how much we have to do jiva doya by being merciful to the jivas. So that is important that we give charity so that we can be part of the society, part of a community which is helping the whole upgradation of the society.
Now we will discuss, because actually the group is mixed, you know, we will discuss some things which are useful for those who are not married and something which is useful also for those who are married. So in Srimad Bhagavatam, it is mentioned the very important position of women in Vedic culture. Bhishma Dev, when he was on his deathbed, you know, and the Pandavas have won the battlefield, at that time Krishna tells Yudhishthira and all the Pandavas that you dress up the best you can, and as a king, they came in front of Bhishma Dev, who was lying on his deathbed. And at that time, King Yudhishthira asked Bhishma Dev, can you please give me some instructions? So one of the instructions he gives is how in society we should respect women. Because she is representing actually Lakshmi Devi. Bhishma Dev says that where women are honored, even the demigods are pleased. If women folk are not honored, all acts of that home becomes fruitless. If the woman in a family live in grief, then that family will become extinct. Women are deities of prosperity. the virtue of men depends upon women. Why? Because actually a woman, as a mother, she imparts the good virtues to both the girl and the boy. So she is the one, as a woman, who is giving all the culture and values to her children. The virtue of men depends upon women. Once Srila Prabhupada was asked by one of the Western reporter that I have read Bhagavad Gita and some of your scriptures, and where you say that women are, you know, they are not so intelligent and you don't respect women. And Prabhupada said, no, how can we do that? He said, do you know the three prominent deities who rule the universe? He said, which are the three most important portfolios in any country, you know? He's saying, who is the deity of portfolio of finance? Huh? Lakshmi. The second very important portfolio is knowledge. Saraswati. And whose defense? Durga. He's saying, if all three powerful positions Krishna gives to three ladies, how can I disrespect women? And he said, Krishna himself is controlled by Srimati Radharani. So, first thing we have to understand that we must learn to respect women. And respect to women is shown by two ways. Srila Prabhupada said that all women except wife should be told Mataji. In ISKCON, a woman is be addressed as Matajis. A woman imparts samskaras to the children, so she is object of worship, not exploitation.
And the woman is always to be protected. Because, you know, the way the nature of woman is that they tend to be very devoting, very, very trusting and faithful, and they like to follow. So they need to be always protected. So for the woman, they should understand that they should always be under protection. And for the man, it is important what is the need of a woman, and they need to be protected. When a woman is shy and chaste and restrained, she cannot be exploited, and she earns the respect of the woman. And how do we earn the respect of women?
Men.
Of men. And many times, we see that by, what is a better way of getting respect? Is it by demanding or by commanding? What is a better way? Either one, but the higher one is that you command respect, you don't demand respect, right? I mean, if by your behavior you are commanding the respect that people, that they give you. If you demand respect, people give you're demanding and they're fulfilling.
They're doing out of fear.
But you are commanding respect. So there was this one example of in Srila Prabhupada's life where, you know, Prabhupada and many, many senior sannyasis were walking on the street. Prabhupada would go on morning walks. So they're walking on the street. And, then they came across a lady who was sweeping the street. She was a street sweeper. But the moment Prabhupada came, she went aside. She covered her face. This was in India. And then she allowed the sannyasis to go. And she did it in a such regal and a respectful way that Prabhupada and sannyasis, they stopped and they respected her gesture of giving respect to them. And Prabhupada spoke about this in many, many places, about this behavior of a woman. So she didn't demand respect, but she, even though she was just an ordinary street sweeper, but by her very, very chaste behavior and respectful behavior, she commanded respect from sannyasis and Prabhupada. And that's how, you know, she was. So this was a classical example of that. We don't really demand the respect, but by her shyness, by her chastity, and, you know, by her being submissive, she actually commands the respect.
It is not that a woman, by becoming submissive, she becomes inferior. Many times women feel that, oh, if I have to become humble and submissive, that means I'm inferior. No. If you see a drama or if a movie, to make it complete, somebody has to play a role of a hero, somebody has to play a role of a comedian, somebody has to play a role of a villain. So in a Grihastha life, husband and wife, both of them are playing a role. Where nature, by the nature, a male has a very, by the way Krishna has made them, they were male ego. So that needs to be satisfied. And how a woman satisfies that? By becoming shy, submissive. And the way she is so submissive, that the man loves her so much that he is ready to do whatever she says. And what she says, I will do whatever you say. But she makes the man speak what she wants. Are you getting the point? So by her shyness, by her submissiveness, actually she wins the heart of the husband.
One of the very, very important aspects that we need to understand is the interaction between man and woman. Because while we are in a spiritual society, there are certain important standards. And as Prabhupada and our scriptures explain, that man is considered is like butter and woman is like fire. And what is the speciality of this relationship between butter and fire? The butter melts when? When it is close to the fire. But if butter is a kilometer away and fire is here, it would not, won't be any problem, right? So Prabhupada was teaching a very, very important aspect of culture, as she mentioned about culture. What is the culture of a society which is fast diminishing all over the world, including India, which was supposed to be a place of culture, but is horribly fast, very fast reducing, is, and that happens when there's a degradation in the behavior between man and woman. So we need to understand what is the ideal standard between a man and a woman. So it is not that married life, for those who are not married yet are going to get married, those who are even married. It is not that married life is a license to be free or frivolous with women or with men. Because we need to all constantly understand that at any at, one second, it's here. That we should, as she said, that we should address the woman as Mataji, every woman as Mataji. So we see every woman as mother, and that means that we cannot be frivolous with the women. Because what happens in frivolity? That we take things very, very cheaply. That we know, the women naturally like to laugh on jokes. And they sometimes they laugh quite silly, in a silly jokes. So when I'm sorry to say that, but men, some when they know this, they start cracking silly jokes. Not just for cracking a joke, but to really get that cheap adoration from a woman. And that creates frivolity in the whole environment, which actually spoils the environment, which pollutes the environment, which creates negative vibrations in the environment, which are not conducive for Krishna consciousness. So a very, very strong restraint is required in dealing with men and women, and that means as much as possible the interaction should be minimal. There should be minimal interaction, and that's why whatever management needs to be done to really have this interaction as minimal as possible should be done. Now of course, practically speaking, if something has to be executed, that can be done. But in order to maintain the purity of our temples and purity of our relationships, these things are very, very important. So it should be respectful and not frivolous. Talking to women should be need-based and not desire-based. That there's a need, then we talk to women, and ideally it should be done in front of her husband or along with your wife. That's ideal. That's safe. That's like a proper safe environment where things are having proper standards, and obviously we cannot take counseling from a man counselor. The woman can't be counseling the man counselor, and the man can't be the woman counselor. That, because what is counseling? Counseling means that you are just taking help, and obviously you cannot just have that relation, because we have to maintain the sanctity of the ashram.
If you need a counseling from a, suppose if you are unmarried person, boy, or you are a couple and you need counseling, a Mataji needs a counseling, then she should be, you know, either with her husband in front of the counselor couples, or it should be done in the presence of the counselor couple, never alone. You know, never the relation between a man and a woman, other than the husband and wife, should never be sitting alone or discussing very intimately about their lives. Services that involve too much interaction with women, this is for men, should be done through the wife. Or similarly for the wife, services that involve too much interaction with brahmacharis and other men should be done through husband. This one aspect, if we maintain that, you know, closest relationship is husband and wife relationship, and other relationships, they become need-based. Only if you need to talk, and that should be also done preferably in the presence of, if you need to talk to a Mataji, in front of her husband or in front of the wife. It should never be alone.
You know, when we were mentioning this particular things, you know, we were in Moscow a few years back, and we had certain sannyasis, Devamrit Swami Maharaj, Niranjan Maharaj, senior sannyasis of ISKCON sitting there, and said, this is so very important, you need to stress it everywhere. We were feeling a little hesitant, you know, with that, you know, maybe it might be a little bit too much to tell people outside of India, you know, there's a different culture. He said, no. And then Devamrit Maharaj in his own very, they said, butter is butter, whether it is American butter or London butter, it melts. It is not an Indian butter only melts, every butter melts. So you should say this everywhere. Is that okay? I said, yes, Maharaj, your orders. You know? So this is important. And on their order, we are just saying that, because many times we feel that, well, you know, it's in our culture. I mean, this is not so much of, you know, there is free mixing from beginning, and we are brought up with this free mixing. So, Prabhu, please don't get your Indian stuff here and all these things. But if we are really looking at purity of relationship, which Prabhupada wanted. Prabhupada wanted our temples and communities to be very pure in the relationship. And we want to really maintain the purity of relationship, then this is a number one pollutant of the communities. Free mixing of men and women. It pollutes the environment, pollutes the whole... So let us understand briefly about, because, you know, we are trying to figure out so we can cater to both the needs. So we are just the needs of the unmarried and needs of married. So we are just trying to. So let us understand in brief what are the duties of the husband. Because we know who we are, we know where to go, we know the path, we discuss the path also. But while we are on that path, we all have our duties to play, is it not? So we need to understand our duties of a husband. So first, a real Vaishnava tries to understand how much his wife is helping him or her in his devotional service. This is in a situation where the wife is a devotee. But also, if even the wife is not a devotee, that the wife offers the particular stable platform for the husband to execute Krishna consciousness, even if at that juncture, if she is not an active devotee for whatever reason. But the husband should always be very, very grateful and understand how much the wife is helping him in his life. So what is the first quality that is required? The duty is, the important duty of husband is to be grateful. And if you are not grateful, then you are a great fool. That's about it. Because the natural quality of a human being, of a gentleman, is to be grateful for anything anybody does for you. And how much a wife gives support, and you will understand when you do get married that how much she will do for you. Great Vaishnavas never neglect, demean or cast ill remarks on their wives. You see any examples in our Shastras. Take any great souls, any powerful kings. And if they have done it, like in the case of Uttanapad, when it Suruchi and Suniti,
you got severe reactions.
Severe reactions. So you find any great souls, they will always be very respectful, they never neglecting or demean or have cast ill remarks. But nowadays, many times, and it has become this unfortunate you know, men's chauvinism, is it what it's called? They just try to, you know, show that, you know, and, you know, as part of their ego satisfaction, when they are in front of with people, they just say, oh, you are a useless lady, you know, she doesn't know what to talk. And they marvel, ha, 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 and they find great happiness in doing so. And that is sad. It may not be happening so much in Western, but in India, it's unfortunate that, you know, the ladies are not seen as somebody who don't get the respect but that is never the case in the Shastras. Our Shastras always teaches the men to be respectful, never neglecting, never demeaning, and never casting ill remarks. The primary duty of husband is to help the wife's Krishna consciousness and train her nicely. So the first duty of the husband is to train the wife and help her in a Krishna consciousness, and you cannot help somebody unless and you're helping yourself. So the first duty of the husband, as we understand, is to have first class sadhana. He is, as we call, not in literal sense, but as we call, the guru of the house. Not that he starts behaving like a guru, but he is the guru, means he's a teacher of the house. He sets a good example to the people by his own sadhana and by his own behavior. And very important, you know, provide all facilities to one's wife of food, shelter and clothing, maintenance of the house and children. It is not maya to provide the wife something more than basic also. many times, you know, husband says, I will provide you just the basic things, okay? Because I don't want to get into maya, because anyway, I'm in maya right now that I got married to you, you know? So I don't want to get into bigger maya. So I will just have a very, very small house and a not very luxurious car for you. You know, just because, you know, all these things just gets me more entangled. So just the bare minimum, and don't ask anything more than that, okay? Is that clear? But that's being cruel. Being a devotee husband does not mean that you become impractical in your dealings. A woman is a human being. My Gurudev, Radhanath Maharaj, was saying that many a times, you know, devotees, they are very, very compassionate at heart. They believe in Jeev Doya. They don't even eat non-vegetarian food. They're very kind to the animals. They support, you know, protection of animals. But they're cruel to their wives. What a paradox. They're cruel to their husbands. What a paradox. It is duplicity. It is this hypocrisy that we do that. Being very nice to the animals, you know, that giving the dog all the comfort, but being cruel to your wife and not providing even the basic necessities, or little more than basic necessities, to her. So that is not the duty of the husband, to be very, very, provide all the facilities. A husband should be faithful, devoted and dutiful. And we should be considerate and loving at all times, you know, especially, you know, when the wife is going through her difficult times of her health or whatever. You know, many times we have seen so many examples that, you know, the wife says, oh, I am really sick. What is the first answer? You know, because we heard it, Mataji, or you are not the body. That means it is the right philosophy, but misapplied. What he's saying is not wrong. She's obviously not the body. But wrong application, as we say, to apply the right philosophy based on time, place and circumstance, desh, kal and patra, TPC, time, place, circumstance. So to say the right thing at the wrong time is wrong, right? So this is very important, to be considerate and to be loving, to be humane in your behavior. Yeah, finish that.
Now let's understand the duties of wife. The wife is called Ardhangini. She's actually half body of the husband. Means whatever activity the husband does, the spiritual activity, even if she does not do anything spiritual activity, she shares half of the benefits. A wife is accepted not as half, but better half. Because she is the one who actually, man is responsible for discharging all the duties, and she assists the husband in doing all that duty. A wife makes a Grihastha Ashram safe. Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport of King Puranjana, In the story of King Puranjana Prabhupada says that the body is like a fort and the senses are like plunderers and the wife is the commander of the fort. In other words, when one's consciousness is attacked by the call of the senses, then the wife, the commander of the fort, comes to one's rescue. She is the protection of the husband, and husband who would otherwise go astray and perform irreligious activities. She controls her husband not by harsh words, but by not by arrogance or not by challenging him, but as we mentioned earlier, by her shyness, by her affection, by her chastity, and by her serving spirit. When a wife is submissive to the husband, she makes herself, you know, that she's dependent on the husband, then the man naturally likes to protect her. Srila Prabhupada has mentioned many times that when a woman thinks that, I'm independent, I don't need you, when she gives the man that feeling, then the man just says, okay, I leave you, you know. If you don't need me, then I don't feel like protecting you. But when the woman, by her behavior of, you know, very chaste, very shy, very submissive, very always in good serving, you know, service mood, she draws that protection from the man. Also, we say that if a man is supposed to see all the other women other than his wife as mother or Mataji, then we should behave like mothers. The way we dress up, the way we are doing our activities, it should be very, very chaste, not, you know, trying to arouse the other emotions in the men. There are many advices which we have taken from scriptures. When Sita, you know, Sita and Ram were going in the forest, okay, we can see from this parallel, from this story, that when Lord Ramchandra was banished to the forest, and he told that I will go alone to the forest. At that time, Sita Mai said, no, I will come with you. So now we see, Ram wanted Sita to stay back in Ayodhya and take care of his parents. And suppose if we consider that as a submissive, humble wife, she should have done that. But what did she do? She said, no, I want to come with you. He said, no, but I am instructing you to stay with my parents and my, you know, brothers, and you take care of them. He said, no, but my parents have given me instruction, my father, when I was coming from Mithila, that whatever, wherever your husband stays, you should stay there. So then Ram said, but you are a princess. You have never even walked bare feet. You know, how will you walk with me in the forest? You know, there will not be any food, not good clothing, not proper shelter. You'll have to walk bare feet. And, you know, he was concerned. As a genuinely loving husband, he was concerned that how will you stay? You are a princess, you have never stayed. The banishment is for me. I will go to the forest. You don't need to come with me. He said, no, I will come with you. So you can see here that Sita Mai was actually arguing. And she wanted her point to be taken as correct. And then Ram was not listening to her. Then finally Sita became very angry. In Rama, in actual words, Valmiki Muni writes, Sita Mai tells Lord Ram that I am telling you, my father has told me to come with you. And saying, you don't want me to come because you are not a man, you are a eunuch. These are the exact words, you know, she has used. And then Ram says, okay, chalo, wind up, come with me.
Shock treatment.
Shock treatment. So, we can see here that, you know, she is submissive, but at the same time, she wanted to follow in the footsteps of her husband. She was not comfortable that my husband is staying in the forest and I will be staying in the palace. He will be eating all roots and I will be eating, you know, nice food. So she wanted to follow in the footsteps of Lord Ram. So a wife is submissive, she's chaste. It's not that submissive doesn't mean that she cannot open her mouth or she cannot argue with her husband. She can argue. She has all the right to give her opinion. But at the same time, she does it for the full intention of always serving her husband and making the relationship always very strong. And what happens in the modern world nowadays, the woman is also sometimes earning a lot of money. The man is also earning a lot of money. And then they don't want to be cooperative staying together. I can do without you, you can do without me. Then if they don't have that dependency on each other, if they don't feel that I need you and I need you also, if the husband doesn't feel that I need my wife and the wife doesn't feel that I need my husband, then they cannot work together. So there has to be very, very strong foundation of trust and love. And how does it come? By each one playing their role very nicely. And the role of the husband is providing all the physical, mental, emotional, spiritual needs of the wife. And the wife, by remaining very humble, submissive, shy, chaste wife, these are not the only qualities, but many more, by keeping the house very clean, cooking very nice prasadam. One of the very good qualities is that she should cook herself. Many times it's said that a way to a man's heart is through his stomach. We have seen so many cases. Recently we were handling a divorce case, and almost the case was, you know, that finally the papers are gone. And one fine day we heard the husband withdrew the case. And he said, no, actually I don't like her, but the way she cooks, nobody else can cook.
Serious?
Serious. And now they are staying together happily. So what we are trying to say is, you know, it's the when, like, we have our one very prominent brahmachari, and he always reads a lot of, you know, Ramayana from South India, and he says that again scriptures mention that a wife must cook for the family, you know, or a mother must cook for the family. By cooking, actually, she is getting that, you know, she is giving her love to the family, and there is a connection. Through food, there is connection. If the wife doesn't cook, nowadays modern culture is wife is also working, husband is also working, somebody else cooking food for them, and they can't stay together. But in olden days, you see, even the poor people, they eat something very simple, but they have very good loving relationship. Why? Because whatever the husband would earn, he would give to the wife, from that she would manage the house. And there was good love and trust. So that comes by doing certain things. By keeping the house clean, by cooking for the husband. We have seen two instructions where Sita ji was in forest, Anusuya, the wife of Atrimuni. She gave a very nice instruction to Sita Mai. She says, worlds that are attended with great prosperity await those women to whom their husband is dear, no matter whether he lives in a city or a forest, whether he is very advanced or not very advanced. This instruction is at the very root of a successful grihastha life. Husband's honor must be wife's honor, his joy, her joy. Once Queen Draupadi, she met with the eight queens of Krishna. No. Draupadi was one lady managing five husbands, and here eight principal queens managing one Krishna. And they were asking, you know, the eight principal wives, that we eight of us can't please Krishna. How can you one please five husbands? Please give us some tips. How do you manage them? And she said, and especially who asked this? Satyabhama. You know, who is a naughty, naughty wife of Krishna. She said, how do you manage this? So she said, the eternal virtue for women is based on her concern for her husband. The husband is a wife's god or master and her shelter. Truly, she has no refuge. Whether I am sleeping, eating, or ornamenting myself, I never act against the will of my husband. Always directed by them, I never speak badly even about my mother-in-law. So Draupadi is even talking about the in-laws. And she says that I always serve my husband's first. My heart is not disposed with any other male to be human or celestial, Gandharva, young, wealthy or handsome. I never bathe, eat or sleep till my husband and our servants have done that. If my husband is away from home, then I don't dress up very nicely. You know, I am in front of them, then I dress up very nicely. When my husband returns from the filled woods or towns, I immediately get up and offer my respects by providing them with water and seat. I am always busy serving my husband and I never desire to be away from them. So she is constantly saying that how she is showing by all this activity, what is she showing? she's giving men the confidence that I am completely yours. Once a man gets that confidence, this woman is mine, he's ready to do anything for her. But for that, she has to behave in a particular way to win that confidence from him. Very important instruction Srila Prabhupada gives in the 9th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Then even if the husband is irritable, does something a little off, a wife must be understanding and take this tendency in her stride and adapt herself to her husband's situation to the best of her ability. Don't expect the husband should do it first. It is a wife who adapts to the husband's irritable nature. And she, by her behavior, actually changes the husband.
So, you know, one of the very important reasons why many times we have problems in married life is we don't understand the psychology of a man and a psychology of a woman. Because whether we like it or not, God has created man and woman differently. Not to say that one is better than the other, but just sheer differently. Just like we have apple and peaches. They are two different fruits. Can we say one is better than the other? No, but they are different. And they are completely different. So we need to understand the psychology of a man and the psychology of a woman. So what is a man's psychology? A man's sense of self is defined through his ability to achieve results. A man, where does he get his strength from? He's a very result-oriented person. The way Krishna has made a man is very result-oriented. And how does a woman get her strength? Is a woman's sense of self is defined through her feelings and quality of her relationships. Now, she's not so much of a result-oriented person, but she's a very she's more subtle in the sense that her self is defined through her feelings and emotions. To offer this is for you know for a man's cycle to offer a man unsolicited advice is to presume that he does not know what to do or that he cannot do it on his own. You know, many times, you know, the woman are naturally loving and the man does particular things and she says, I think you should do it like this. Without the man really asking. And then there's a whole volcano erupt, boom. And the woman said, well, I just told you out of my concern for you. Why are you so angry? Little does the woman know that by giving unsolicited advice to a man, how does a man take it? You know, she has done it from her way. This is the way. But how does a man take it? That you are trying to say that I do not know it? That you are trying to teach me that I can't do it and that's why I should do it this way? That's how the man takes it. That's why if we know how man and woman's psychology work, for example, if a man does not understand how a woman is different, he can make things worse and he's trying to help. Men should remember that women talk about problems, not to really deal with problems, but to get closer. They really don't want solutions, and we will read out to you a very, very classical situation. What happens many times? You know, the woman says, oh, I'm so tired. Okay. A problem. And the man says, then why did you cook the Mangala Arati sweets today? Solution, right? The first thing you want to give a solution. But my dear friend, she's not saying that she's tired just because she wants a solution. She wants to just be close to you. And we'll read out to you a very classical situation. We'll be able to understand it. He said, for Bhakti is a wife and Deva is the husband. So Bhakti comes home from an exhausting day. Okay? She wants to and she wants and needs to share her feelings about the day. So Bhakti says, there is so much to do, I don't have any time for myself. Deva says, you should quit that service. You don't have to work so hard. Find something you like to do. Okay. So this is what husband is saying. Nice thing. You ask me, I'm giving a solution. So right till now, husband is very clear. What happens? Bhakti says, but I like my service. They just expect me to change everything at a moment's notice. Deva says, don't listen to them. Just do what you can do. Bhakti says, I am. I can't believe I completely forgot to call my aunt today. Deva says, don't worry about it. She'll understand. Bhakti says, don't you know what she is going through? She needs me. Deva says, you worry too much. That's why you are so unhappy. Bhakti angrily says, I am not always unhappy. Can't you just listen to me? Deva says, I am listening. Bhakti says, why do I even bother to talk to you? So what happened? The conversation went for a complete toss. Right? She was trying to tell more and more things of the whole day. And she was just staying one after another. You know, it's so exhausting. I like my service. And, you know, and in the experiment to change at a moment's notice. You know, and then,
Forgot to make a call
to my aunt. So one by one, she was just selling. And husband was one by after another. This solution, that solution, that solution. It ended up into a... She was completely pissed off, as we say. And now we will say, so what should be the ideal situation? One is the
understanding of the psychology of men.
One is on the psychology that a woman wants to come up problems, not necessarily to find a solution, but to really be close. So like this. Bhakti says, there is so much to do, I have no time for him. Deva takes a deep breath, relaxes on exhale and says, sounds like you had a hard day. But he says, they expect me to change everything at the moment's notice. I don't know what to do. Deva pauses and says, this is not to say the husband who says, say. But you will understand further. But he says, I have even forgotten to call my aunt. Deva says, with a slight wrinkled brow, oh no. Bhakti says, she needs me so much right now, I feel so bad. Deva says, you are such a loving person.
Deva says, you are such a loving person.
Deva gives Bhakti a hug and she relaxes in his arms with a big sigh of relief. She then says, I love talking to you. You make me really happy. Thanks for listening, I feel much better. So if you see from the decibel point of for the quantum of talking point of view, in the first conversation the husband talked much more, but resulted in a complete fiasco. But in the second conversation, the husband didn't talk much more, but he was really understanding the feelings. Try to understand. It is not that we are trying to manipulate each other here. Please understand. We are trying to be just sensitive to the way Krishna has made each other. I mean, Krishna has made a man and a woman. And a woman, if we understand this very clearly, and I have seen it n number of times in my own case and in other ways, that we need to understand many times the man is, as we say, we are result-oriented people, right? Our self is defined by results. So we apply the same logic to when we deal with our wives and say, okay, you are doing this, you do this, and do this, do this. But, I mean, wife is not looking for a solution. She's looking for relationships. There's a complete difference in apples and peaches. Right? So if this conversation, just what is Deva doing with Bhakti? He's just understanding her, he's being with her, and there's a whole, when she wants to tell, and her whole anger and whole exhaustion is simply relaxed, just knowing the fact that my husband understands me, he's with me. So that's what is important.
We were talking, you know, when we were preparing the seminar, we were talking to his holiness Bhakti Vidya Purna Maharaj. And he was the one who was actually explaining to us about the psychology of men and women. And he was telling that most of us, what we try to do is, you know, ISKCON devotees, we are on the physical platform. And straight from the physical, we want to jump to the spiritual platform. But we neglect mental and emotional platform. So if you try to neglect, you know, you may feel that this is, you know, this example we just read, it's a very, you know,
mundane
example. But no, you know, you cannot just go straight to the spiritual. We still have needs of the body. We still have the needs of the mind. And how do you tackle them? You know, you cannot go straight from physical to spiritual. Once, if the wife or a husband, we know all of us, all those who are married, if you are disturbed mentally in your relationship, however much you may be sitting to chant your rounds, you cannot concentrate on a chanting. You may be right inside the altar dressing Radha Landaneshwar. But in your mind you may be thinking of the argument which you had with your husband or wife. You know, it's your consciousness just brings you so low. So what is important? What is important is to cater to those needs, you know, and then you go on a higher platform. Similarly with children. Sometimes we want our children straight right from day one to be like Prahlad Maharaj and Dhruva Maharaj. But what we need to do is, we need to cater to their needs. They also have their needs. Each person has their needs. And when you cater to those emotional needs, what happens? There's a very strong relationship between husband and wife. When that strong relationship, one, the foundation is very strong, what happens? They are together. No